Sunshine, fresh air. We got the team behind us. So let's play two.
Arnie Banks made history on September 17, 1953, when he made his first on-field appearance in the Cubs uniform. He was the first African-American to do so, 6 years after Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier for all of Major League Baseball. He had a show-stopping career with a whole host of accomplishments to his name, including MVP, All-Star, Hall of Famer, and even holding a 30-year career home run record. He was hailed as the first African-American manager in 1972 after the original manager was ejected from the game. Cubs fans loved his attitude even more than his stats, with his sunny disposition and true love of the game making him stand out, earning him his iconic nickname, Mr. Cub.
Now, the truth of the matter is that we all know Ernie as the first black player for the Cubs. But in a way, Gene Baker really should have been.
Banks is considered by many the greatest player in Cubs history, but he probably wouldn't have gotten to that point without the influence of Gene Baker.
When the Cubs signed Baker in 1950, he played shortstop for the Monarchs. So after he was signed by the Cubs, Banks the next year played shortstop for the Monarchs. So Banks followed a Baker as a shortstop for the Monarchs.
He actually signed with the Cubs in 1950, which is only 3 years after Jackie Robinson became the first black player in the major league. But they left him in the minor leagues for 4 years. He was ready to play in the major leagues in 1950. But finally, late in the 1953 season, they brought him up to the major leagues. And at the same time, they'd signed Ernie Banks, who also was a shortstop.
Gene Baker took the field for the first time on September 20th, 1953, just 3 days after his new teammate, which landed him in second place in the history books.
The story always was that the Cubs didn't want to bring up Ernie by himself as the first black player, so that they brought up Gene Baker with him. Gene was 6 years older than her, so he was a little wiser in the ways of the world.
Baker had been in the Navy. He'd been in the minor leagues for 4 or 5 years. He knew what he was doing. He knew what the world was like for black athletes, and Banks didn't. So, I mean, that he really was very much a mentor to him that way.
Baker was the one that really taught Ernie Banks to play shortstop. Baker was originally a shortstop, and that was his best position. But when he came up with the Cubs wanted Banks to play shortstop and Baker to play second base.
Yeah, there's a story that when they finally did decide to play Baker, he went out there for pregame infield practice and he ran out to shortstop because that's all he'd ever played. And Banks was standing there and there was some confusion over which one was going to play shortstop. And they finally told Baker he was going to be playing second base. It's the first time he ever played second base in his entire life was in a Major League Baseball game.
They were the first African-American double play combination, meaning second baseman and shortstop. In the National League.
When they got there in 1953, there were only a few games left. So they really didn't have much to go on. 1954 was an entirely different season. Ernie was the starting shortstop. Gene was the starting second baseman. You could see that they were really a terrific double play combination. People throughout the league remarked on it. People were comparing them to some great Cubs double play combinations in the past. They even got their own nickname, Bingo and Bango. Ernie was Bingo and Gene was Bango. And in the next year or two, they really established themselves as, if not the finest, one of the finest double play combinations in the league.
The two of them played together through 1954, 55, 56. In 57, they traded him to the Pirates. He suffered a pretty bad knee injury that pretty much ended his career. But so he played a few games in 1961. And then the Pirates thought enough of him to make him the first black manager in the minor leagues.
That year in Batavia, we had two managers, Jim Adlam, and then we also had, keep in mind, 1961, they talk about the first black managers in professional baseball. Well, Gene Baker, who was a major league second baseman, became our manager in 1961 in Batavia.
And then he went on to have a career as a coach and as a scout and everything after that. But so he only played parts of 8 seasons in the major leagues. Had 3 really, really good years. Was a National League All-Star in 1955 and played every inning of every game that year. So he really for a few years was a very good player in the major leagues.
As good as his career was, Ernie Banks became a household name while Gene Baker did not. Baker taught Banks how to love and live in the spotlight, but he himself shied away from it, to the point where one of the biggest barriers he broke went entirely unnoticed until it happened again 10 years later by none other than Ernie Banks himself.
Ernie used to go around saying that he was the first black manager because when he was a coach with the Cubs in 1973, both the manager and the third base coach got kicked out of a game. And so Ernie was made the manager for one couple of innings of one game. And he used to say that he was the first black manager. Well, he was wrong. Just as Gene maybe should have been the first black Cub, Gene was the first black manager 10 years earlier, in 1963. The same thing happened. And Gene, who was, I believe, the first base coach, managed the team for the remaining few innings that were there.
Baker and Banks, they still had to deal with the racial discrimination and prejudice that was in Major League Baseball.
He actually, in 1943, was actually cut from his high school baseball team. He was good enough to play 8 years in the major leagues, but he didn't make his high school baseball team. And I wasn't there, obviously, but it's fairly obvious that it was because of the color of his skin.
It was late in 1953 in St. Louis. And because they were living at an all-black hotel in the South Coast town, the white Cubs got on the train at Union Station. And then for the first time that anybody could remember or it had ever happened, they stopped at the 63rd Street Station on the south side of town, and where all black people, where many black people. And as Ernie and Gene got on the train for the first time, one white Cub who had never seen that stop said, "Where are we? South Africa?"
This is at a time when these are star Cub players, future Hall of Famers. So they were players who were cheered and adored when they were on the field, but when they were off the field, they were, quote, just another black person that did not get equal treatment.
What really amazed some of the white players about the African-American players that came up in the 1950s, because they still had to deal with racism. They still had to prove themselves to be better than the white players in order to make the team. A lot of the white players would say, "I don't understand how they did that with all the pressure they were under, with all the limitations they had to deal with. But they still performed at a high level."
Just as baseball was slow to integrate after Jackie Robinson integrated the game as a player, it was also slow to integrate with black managers. There weren't very many, and there still aren't very many. But Gene had really established himself as a fine manager in the Pirates minor leagues, and again, at a high level. He should have had a chance. He might have been a very good manager.
Baker probably would have been, a more of an all-star. You know, he would have gotten to play with the Cubs 3 years earlier than he did, you know, if he was white. And Banks, you know, they probably both would have been with the Cubs earlier if they had been black. So I think that's probably the main thing that would have changed if they were not African-American.